We're living longer these days, which is a good thing. But with added longevity, we may be working longer by choice or by necessity. So what does it take to be employed for life? I'm Grace Trafton of The Better Part. Stay tuned and find out about this pertinent topic. Dr. Tracey Wilen is a thought leader, global speaker, media contributor, and the author of 11 books. Her latest book, Employed for Life, is a 360-degree look at employment and careers in the 21st century. Welcome, Tracey.
Thank you, Grace.
It's so good to see you again.
Oh, thank you for having me again.
What do leading HR executives have to say on the subject of modern-day talent management?
You know, Grace, talent management continues to evolve. For example, when I started work, the loyal employee was the way to go. But today, it's really all about the entrepreneurial employee, the person who can look at their job like a CEO. What can I add value? Also, the A player definition has changed somewhat to the T person. It's a big word, transdisciplinarity. But what it really means is that it's no longer just breadth or depth. It's actually both. We can't just be a generalist or a specialist in our jobs, and we actually have to be more technical. So I think as work evolves, we need to realize that talent management is also evolving.
And how does the globalization impact work and employees?
You know, globalization is very interesting. When I started work, globalization meant exporting from one country to another. But today, if you look at like a platform like eBay, you can actually open up an international business in an hour and take international currency. So every business has the ability to be global. But at the same time, it also flattens labor. Because if you think about it, I can go out to Elance, which I do, which is a marketplace online where I can find talent to edit videos, write for me, edit for me, copyright, ghostwrite even, or do a number of tasks at a very low cost. And some people will just bid on projects for $2 an hour. So globalization can be as far-reaching as expanding the pie, but also being creating more competitiveness as individuals to be employed.
Do people really work at $2 an hour?
Well, you have to remember the economy is different, right? The cost of living varies worldwide. So you might find a great writer in Philippines who has a much lower cost of living than here. And a $2 or $3 an hour is a good rate. Where in the United States, you might find even city to city, our cost of living does vary. So yeah, you absolutely can find people at different cost variables.
So you're drawing employees from all over the world.
I do. In my personal business, I do look to see where the talent pools are and where, you know, if I do need some video work done, where are the experts? If I need analysis or statistics done, where are the experts? And, you know, writing, you know, where are the experts? And you can find, actually, countries have patterns, and you can find people globally who do great work.
You've implied with globalization comes diversity. How has increased diversity added to the complexity of the workplace?
You know, Grace, when I started work, everybody entered the workforce at the same age, and everybody seemed to exit at the same age. Now you look at a workforce today, and there's three generations, and actually McDonald's was telling me they have four generations in their workplace.
Is that right?
That's very diverse, because they can get workers' permits and come in at 14 and a half. And then there's people in their 70s and 80s who want to continue to be employed and actually find jobs there as well. So if you think about the technology differences in those four generations, some have no technology background and
right.
Some have a lot. There's different levels of experience. There's different levels of education. So diversity is, you know, on multiple levels. It's not just about male, female, or, you know, ethnic background. It's actually age is entered into the as a factor.
So it's more challenging these days for employers and HR professionals.
Well, absolutely. The big concern is how do we train? How do we normalize, right, all of these different levels? And how do they get along, right? You know, can we build teams where the baby boomers and the millennials and Generation X can integrate and play together, so to speak, and work well together? So it creates a lot of challenges in the workplace.
Since we are living longer these days, how has our extended longevity reshaped the concept of retirement and the possibility of multiple careers in a lifetime, not just one career.
Oh, absolutely. You know, you probably hear all the taglines now in the press is saying 50 is the new 30,
yes,
and 80
yes.
is the new 60.
Right.
Well, when I actually interviewed leaders, they said, you know, living to 100 is, you know, top of mind for people, and being able to stay employed long enough to support yourself to live to 100 is pretty important. So retirement is starting to look like, for a lot of people, being closer to 80 than closer to 62, where I think a lot of us envision retirement.
Right, so you're saying that the normal retirement age of 62 or 65 is now outdated.
I think a lot of people would say, I'm not ready to retire at 62. I'm not ready to afford to retire at 62 or 65. And I have a lot more that I want to contribute. Now, the careers may change at that point, right? As I was mentioning earlier, you know, it used to be just the corporation. But now the corporation may just be a stop in one's employment journey. In fact, before you join a corporation, you, as a younger person, you may want to try a startup before joining a corporation. Or as you become more seasoned and experienced, the corporation may not might be enough for you anymore, and you might want to pursue self-employment. You may want to look at other areas of life, look at your special hobbies and developing them. So there's a lot more choices today than in the past.